Hello, everybody, and welcome to this very complicated deep dive session on subject of free speech and academic freedom. I actually want to do an hour and a half on Zika, but nobody else does, so we're just going to stick with the plan. What we're going to do up here is kind of complicated, and it's very packed. We're going to have, within this one session, we're going to have four different panels, so it's going to be a little bit like Penn Station up here, but I'm going to try to run this as efficiently as Amtrak, so we should be okay. I'm not going to do a big wind-up. You all know what the subject is, and to start us off, we have one of the nation's preeminent constitutional scholars, Jeffrey Stone, of University of Chicago Law School, former provost, University of Chicago, former dean, and we're going to, before we bring up the other larger panels, we're going to spend a few minutes talking about, let's say, sort of combination of high theory and practice. Why our universities, both public and private, seem to be in a continuing crisis over matters of speech, free speech on campus. So thank you for being here. And also, he's going to have to leave because he's so important that he's on two panels at once, which is not an easy thing to do. But why don't you start off this conversation by taking a few minutes and talking about the nature of the current crisis, if you indeed agree that it is a crisis. And from your perspective, what aren't some combination of students, administrators, and faculty understanding about both the First Amendment and a university's, both public and private, obligation to free speech and the way they define free speech? And I'll let you go right from there.
Okay, well, let me start by saying a bit about academic freedom, which, at least in the abstract, we generally understand to be essential to the mission of universities. But academic freedom, it turns out, is often too much taken for granted. People assume it's kind of a rule of nature, it takes care of itself, we don't have to worry about it, and nothing could be further from the truth. The reality is that the principle of academic freedom, which is absolutely essential to universities, is based on the premise that universities are designed to test and establish and question propositions to move towards truth. And one thing we've learned over time is what we believe to be true in any one moment or one generation often turns out to have been wrong or incomplete. And the way we learn that is by discourse and argument and research and learning and challenge and dialogue. And the greatest danger to academic freedom, the greatest danger to that core mission of universities, of seeking out the truth, is a decision at any particular point in time that we know something to be true. And therefore, we don't have to talk about it anymore, and anybody who wants to say anything to the contrary doesn't belong here and should be punished, and that's off the reservation, so to speak. And we've learned that the hard way. The truth is that principle is not one that has been as self-evident as might appear. So if you go back through American history, it turns out there's been an endless struggle to establish this proposition. From the very beginning, when colleges were primarily religious institutions, any faculty member or student who said anything that questioned the dogma of the leaders of that institution would be expelled or would be fired. In the first half of the 19th century, in southern colleges and universities, anyone who questioned slavery or questioned white superiority could be disciplined or expelled. In the late years of the 19th century, when wealthy philanthropists began supporting universities, anyone, student or faculty, who questioned the business ethics or practices of those wealthy philanthropists could be disciplined or expelled. In World War I, anyone who challenged the legitimacy of the draft or of the war would be thrown out of a university anywhere in the nation. During the Cold War, of course, during the era of McCarthyism, any faculty member or student who said anything that was seen as sympathetic to communism, you were gone, not acceptable, and so on. So throughout our history, we have, on the one hand, had this aspiration to academic freedom, and on the other hand, we have had to struggle continually to reinforce it and to establish it. And in each of these instances, and many others I could offer, those who demanded censorship, those who demanded silence by those who disagreed with them, were 100% certain that they were right. They knew the truth, and this speech was dangerous, and it was wrong. And therefore, it was appropriate to silence people who took these other positions. And at the moment, we're dealing with, frankly, a similar set of circumstances. In this context, it's about what we might call loosely political correctness. It's about the desire to censor and suppress speech that is seen to be, by certain groups, and even more generally, hateful, loathsome, inaccurate, marginalizing, and so on. And the point I want to make is, in my own view, much of the speech that is criticized along these lines is those things. From my perspective, much of this speech is hateful and loathsome and unfortunate. But the proper response for it in a university is not censorship, it's not silencing, it's responding. And it's responding vigorously and courageously to establish the truth and to win that battle. And I think the particular danger universities face today is that to the extent we are tempted to yield to these demands for censorship and political correctness, we do not only a great disservice to academic freedom, but we do a great disservice to our students. Because a core responsibility of universities is to prepare our students to be effective citizens in the real world. And the real world is not a safe space. The real world does not shield us from ugliness and hatred and loathsome ideas, whether along these lines or any other. Our responsibility is to make sure our students have the intellectual and analytical skills to be effective at addressing that speech that they dislike.
Do 1 minute on First Amendment obligations, because I think when we have this conversation in shorthand, we talk about people's constitutional obligations, but it's an incomplete conversation.
Right. So I think it's a mistake in talking about this larger national and indeed international issue to focus on the First Amendment, and here's why. The First Amendment, like the Constitution more generally, applies only to government. A private institution like Harvard or Yale or Stanford or the University of Chicago cannot violate the First Amendment. Only a government entity like, say, the University of California or the University of Illinois can violate the First Amendment. The problem of academic freedom goes way beyond the First Amendment. It is just as important, in my view, in private institutions as public. Now, that's not to say that the First Amendment does not have an important role to play as an external constraint on what public institutions can do. So a university like, say, the University of Missouri, if it adopts a certain restriction on speech on campus, might violate the First Amendment and could be held by law to not be permitted to do that. A private institution like Columbia can do that. Nothing in law prohibits it from doing it, but it shouldn't do it, because it's directly incompatible with its core responsibilities as a university.
One more question for you before I know you have to go. Is this cyclical? I mean, you ran through very quickly an interesting history of this. Has this waxed and waned, or is this pressure, from your perspective, on academic freedom a constant in throughout American history? Or it seems as if the last year has been one thing after another, as a viral quality to it.
Well, this particular situation that we're dealing with now is largely unprecedented in the sense that the precise issues that are being contested and discussed are not the same as the ones that have arisen before. What is cyclical is the demands for departure from academic freedom, in the same way that the demands for censorship in society at large often emerge based on circumstances. So right now, for example, there are pressures in society to suppress what might be termed terrorist speech. Now, that issue wasn't something that we were talking about 10, 15 years ago, but it's something we're talking about today, because events in the real world tend to trigger these conflicts. And one of the interesting questions is, what are the events in the real world that have triggered the current conflict in universities, right? And that's a complicated question, and different people have different explanations for it. I would fairly superficially offer two explanations for why I think these issues have arisen now in universities. One of them, I think, is the case that this generation of students, much differently than their predecessors, have been raised in a way that has shielded them. Their parents have shielded them from risk, from conflict, from disappointment, And quite honestly, they are less able to deal with speech that they find offensive and problematic and hateful than prior generations of students were. And that's a real problem, because I think that's not the way you want our citizens to be. And the second part of it, I think, which is a more positive explanation, is that I suspect that we in universities were not aware of the extent to which our students and our faculty, particularly minority faculty and women faculty and students and so on, felt marginalized by certain realities about what was going on in society in general and in universities in particular. And one of the good things about what's happening now is this generation of students actually has the courage to step up and say, look, we have a problem here, and you guys should pay attention to it. My view is it's great that we now have a better understanding of that problem, but the solution is not censorship. The solution is to come to terms with their problem in other ways that don't threaten academic freedom.
Very, very good overview, and we appreciate it very much. And there's a golf cart waiting for you for your next next appointment. Thank you very much
for
coming in.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Very provocative as well. And what we're going to do now is bring up two people who I think you can consider to be on the, there's going to be a video for first, a video. First, and this is going to be a 6-minute video, I believe.
I do so much.
Together as we reclaim this space that will hereby be known as the Residential College formerly known as Calhoun. There was a time when y'all represented John C. Calhoun's vision of America. And this place was marked as white men only. The women and people of color whose labor built this university and this nation were not welcome here. That day is no longer.
Calhoun College is one of the 12 residential colleges at Yale, and so
sounds
if you're
like
part
you
of Calhoun
need to
College,
get into the 4th
you're expected
of July
to,
sale at
to represent
H-H-Gred.
It and to like
Hurry
be very
and
proud
big.
Of the fact that you're in, that you're a Calhounite.
I mean, you've spoken out a lot more on social media after the Orlando shooting.
Yeah.
Calhoun was a slave owner. He thought that black people should be enslaved because they weren't fully human. As a black woman, I understand the importance of names. I understand where they come from. Whereas I don't think a lot of other people seem to see how important that is.
Hi everyone, my name is Elizabeth Spence and I'm the editor-in-chief of Down magazine.
So Down stands for defining our world now. Down is a space where the students of color's perspectives is the most important thing.
We've given people a new language to have this conversation. We changed the way the mainstream media on this campus talks about race, is able to articulate really what's going on this campus.
The ability to express yourself is a privilege. Like many privileges in this country, the people who exercise it most freely are white people.
People of color have felt like their needs weren't being met by the mainstream publication landscape at Yale for a really long time. And so that need has always been there. It wasn't new for me and Sebi to hear that need from our peers, from our communities, and want to respond to it.
The first two sentences are needlessly long.
Strike through both sentences and see what...
Sometimes you just gotta tell the story. If you have a historically white institution, you have to take active steps to diversify it. Nothing we have has been given freely. We've always had to demand it from the administration. It's all about students fighting for what they need.
Racial tensions on Yale's campus are gaining national attention regarding recent events that were seen as racially insensitive. Now, it all started when the Yale College Dean Birgwell Howard sent an email before Halloween, encouraging students to be sensitive in the cultural implications of their costumes. That original letter then prompted a response from Associate Master of Silliman College, Erica Christakis.
The Christakis email exposed something a lot deeper. This email represents the ignorance of the white liberal and the failure of, like, liberal arts education. We ask for this one tiny thing, like, please don't dress up like an Indian. It hurts my feelings. Then a bunch of conservative students got mad, thought their freedom of speech was being infringed on.
I think when people say that issues of race are about freedom of speech, what they're really saying is they don't want to talk about race at all.
I actually wrote a piece last semester called This Is Not an Op-Ed. I saw so many op-eds about what was happening on Yale's campus in November that were dismissing a very important fact that was so important to me. What we were fighting for, what we were talking about, was issues related to our humanity, and that not being seen by the administration, by the world, by so many people looking in on the situation and thinking that we were just whining about things that didn't matter, when it was really rooted in us not being seen and not being seen fully for who we are.
A lot of these attacks have affected mostly, like, brown and black people. But
the free speech argument is a divergent. We've done more speaking on this campus over the past year than I think I've ever seen in my time at Yale. Now let's actually talk about what is happening on our campuses. This ignorant failure of white liberal arts education. This sort of devil's advocate playing thought-provoking thing. Don't do that with my history. Don't do that with my story, my life, my family, my culture. That's not enriching me, that's enriching you.
Yale and universities like it are absolutely failing students of color. The fact that there are protests on college campuses across the country highlights the fact that universities are not separate from what's going on in the rest of the country. They actually are just a microcosm of the discussions that this country is having in general.
Seeing my fellow classmates, like, show up and not accept the decisions made by Yale University about the namings of the colleges, like, that to me was so powerful. It wasn't just saying, okay, like, we fought, we lost. It was saying, we lost, but we're gonna keep trying to win.
Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought. Sing the rising sun of a new day begun. Let us march on, our victory is won.
Thank you, everyone, for doing this reclamation of Calhoun with us. We're not done, we're just starting. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's a very interesting video. I'm curious to hear, among other things, what Stephen Carter has to say about it in the next round. We'll get there in a minute. But right now, I want to welcome to the stage the Dean of Yale College, Jonathan Holloway, on the far side. And next to me, the interim president of the University of Missouri, Michael Middleton. Thank you both for coming up here and talking. The reason we wanted to have these two gentlemen speak next is that they are, in very real ways, on the front lines of this issue. Many of you, most of you, I assume, are familiar with the controversies at both of these schools. Obviously, University of Missouri was an enormous one. He is president because there was a controversy over free speech, but you're now in the middle of it. And of course, Jonathan Holloway was right at the hot center of some of the activities that you saw in that video. So what I want to do in the next 15 to 20 minutes is have both of you talk on two subjects. One, I want you to, briefly as possible, explain to us what happened and how you found yourselves in the middle of these controversies, explain the controversies, and then talk for a few minutes about why these things are happening. Since we just had the video about Yale, why don't we start with you, and maybe you can just talk for a few minutes about how you found yourself in the middle of this and what is this thing that you're in the middle of?
So I saw the video for the first time, just as you did. And there are some basic facts there that we don't need to go into much detail about. Someone in my decanal structure, in my offices, sent an email about Halloween costumes. An associate master of one of the residential colleges took issue with the administration telling people what to do, and then things took off from there. What I think is really, there's one, actually, in the video, one thing you might have missed, a headline saying this is not about a Halloween email. And that's something I hope we get to talk a few moments about, that this was a national convulsion of some type this past year on college campuses, of course at Mizzou and Yale being the first two places, Mizzou being first. If that Halloween email had not been sent, if that response had never come, something else would have happened on campus. So that's where I want to spend more time thinking about. There's something that has changed. What we are seeing at Yale is a radical reorganization, I guess, of our demographics on the campus. And this is not to say we are having troubles because we're letting more black and brown or poor students on campus. I'm not about to say something like that. What we are seeing, though, is that we're having more people who have not come from longer histories or cultures of being at universities or colleges, and there are lots of transition issues and challenges. And when they are seeing their demographic, their age group, in their opinions, being assaulted by the state, they see this as their own experience. Whether you take issue with that or not, this is what the students are seeing. This is part of a larger national challenge, and this is one way for them to address these issues by speaking out.
Could you do a couple of minutes on the moment, and I think a lot of people know this story, where you literally walked into the middle of the maelstrom. You literally came out of your office and were surrounded by a group of very, very upset students. Right. You are the highest ranking African-American official at Yale, and they took out on you a lot of their anger and anxiety. Tell us about that moment.
Sure, I'll relive that for you.
grotesque detail, really, yeah.
So there had been, we were about a week into the unrest on campus at this point, and there had been a lot of evening meetings and things and one, ironically, I couldn't go to because I was giving a book talk on my new edition of Souls of Black Folk, ironically, that this was, I was doing something related to these issues. And there was an event, a chalking event on what we call cross campus, sort of slate rocks, and they're gonna chalk affirmations about their own experiences. So I went out there to actually observe what was happening and to support them. It's important to understand I'm a professor of history, a post-emancipation US history, with a special focus on African American studies, and was teaching a course, my post-emancipation survey course last semester. It was bizarre that I was, in November, as things were heating up on Yale's campus, I was teaching in subsequent weeks, James Baldwin's The Fire Next Time, Malcolm X speaks, and Eldridge Cleaver's Soul on Ice, teaching about black student campus radicalism in the 1960s, and this was happening on Yale's campus at the same time. So I went out there just to be present, and within 3 or 4 minutes of my being there, first 5 or 6 students gathered, then 10 or 12, and then I guess within 10 minutes there were about 200, 250 students surrounding me. And I stood there, I really didn't quite know what to do, I'll confess, except listen. And for the next 2.5 hours, students told me their stories and their frustration and their anger and you name it. Part of that story was we don't understand, someone who writes books on the topics you write books on, someone who teaches the course that you teach and the way that you teach it, that you can stand, you, Dean Holloway, could stand silent while we are going through this experience. I get their confusion. I felt rather, not confused, but vexed, in the sense that as a citizen professor, let's say, not in the administration, I could have said whatever I wanted to say. But as a representative of the institution, I felt quite appropriately that I could not say everything that I was feeling. I have no issue with that as part of my job description, but I had an issue with it personally at that moment, where my politics, my pedagogy, and my scholarship was aligned in a particular way, in many aspects sympathetic to what the students were talking about, because I remember the same stories when I was in college, and I find it really unacceptable that some of the experiences that students, my peers and I were talking about in 85 to 89 are the same issues in 2016 and are the same issues that Yale students were writing about in 1974, that the university has not quite done what it needs to have done on these students. So I sat there and listened and soaked up their frustration. I didn't know what else to do, frankly. And at the very end, there's an elevated space on the plaza, and I asked if I could speak to them. And I shared with them my thoughts, much along the line of what I just told you, and asked for their permission to leave. I had missed, I don't know how many appointments. A fair amount of my staff had come out wondering where I was and found that I was there. I didn't know what to do. I promised that I would do better. And stepped down and walked away. And I'm not afraid to admit that I walked, this sounds more dramatic than it intends. There's a cemetery a half block away. I walked to the cemetery, it's in the middle of the campus, and just sat by myself, because I wasn't ready to go to my office. And I wept like a baby. It's hard to take that type of energy when you're feeling so personally vexed and just think about, well, you know, these young kids, they don't know what they're talking about. We may disagree with their ideas, their approaches. I certainly disagree with a lot of their approaches, I'll say that. But I don't disagree, I don't deny them the sincerity of their feelings. That would be offensive, I think. And it pained me as the person who is charged to, I'm the shepherd of their curriculum. I'm charged, in a sense, to take care of their undergraduate experience from admission to graduation. To hear that much pain related to that experience is a difficult thing to do.
Thank you. Why don't we...
Thank you.
Why don't you, if you can, walk us through as quickly as possible the trauma of the last year at your university. People are familiar with it. You have a unique perspective. You have a unique perspective not only because you're in charge of fixing this, but because you have a very, very long career in, among other things, civil rights law.
Yeah.
And also as someone who is advocating on behalf of freedom of speech in a very, very sensitive time. So walk us through that, if you can.
And I have a very long relationship with the University of Missouri. I was a student there starting in 1964. Finished law school there in 71. And I was a student activist back in the 60s. I presented the first list of demands to the administration by a black student organization that I formed in about 1968. I had taught there for 15 years in the law school. I spent 15 years as an administrator on the Columbia campus. And I had retired. The chancellor hired me back as an advisor because they were beginning to see they had some issues. You have to understand, Ferguson is in Missouri, 100 miles from Columbia campus. The Mike Brown killing was in St. Louis, very close to Columbia. So many of our African-American students really related to what they were seeing on TV and were really upset by it. But what we had on the Columbia campus was really a what I call a perfect storm. We had a failure of leadership on a number of fronts, aside from the race issue. Our deans, in fact, had written a letter to the president, the position I now occupy, to remove the chancellor because of his management style, the threats to academic freedom. Our graduate students had been told within a week of arrival on campus that they would lose their health benefits the next week. We had several controversial decisions with regard to our medical center's relationship to Planned Parenthood. a number of issues were boiling at the time. The chancellor of the Columbia campus had a public forum with the students to talk about their feelings about Ferguson. And what the students did was talk about their feelings about the University of Missouri. And that was when it started blowing up. They staged very, very respectful and peaceful protests, much like what you saw in the film at Yale. They did get rather loud. They did get close to the line. They did block the president's vehicle in the homecoming parade and shout at him through megaphones. They did walk into our alumni center and disrupt a meeting of, I don't know who it was, but they went in and, you know, gave testimony as to how they had been treated, individual speeches of, you know, someone called me the N-word, someone did this to me. The most poignant part of that, I didn't see it until I saw it on a film. There were, you know, 100 students in the hallway all crying as their colleagues were testifying to the treatment they had suffered on that campus. I, having been the deputy chancellor on that campus and recently retired, but back to advise the chancellor, was powerless to do anything but try to advise the chancellor and the president. And what I was advising them to do was exactly what you did. You need to take off your tie, you need to meet with these students, you need to listen to what they're saying, you need to understand, even if you don't understand their lived experiences, you need to accept the fact that they are their experiences, and you need to figure out a way to respond. These are our students. The president had difficulty doing that. The chancellor got it a bit too late. One of the students staged a hunger strike. He was committed to carrying it through. On the seventh day of his hunger strike, the football team joined him and said they wouldn't play again until the president was removed. And on the eighth day of the hunger strike, the president stepped down and the board reassigned the chancellor, leaving a huge vacuum. To my surprise, they called me to come back and serve as interim president and appointed one of the vice presidents as interim chancellor. So here we are. On the speech issues, you know, there were so many points at which people got on the wrong side of the First Amendment. And I think my position, I'm a strong advocate.
Where did they get on the wrong side of the First Amendment?
Well, one, the students claim safe space and a public space. They're on our quadrangle. They built their tent city, and after the president resigned, they formed an area on the quadrangle in the middle of campus and claimed that the media could not encroach upon that space. They wanted privacy. They have no legal right to do that. Most of the media that was there, though, respected that circle of allies that had gathered. It must have been 300 or 400 people forming a circle around the group, and didn't attempt to broach that line. One student reporter, exercising his First Amendment right to cover the event, was trying to push through the crowd. One of our faculty members, who is probably notorious by now.
An ex-faculty member.
Ex-faculty member, you know, tried to remove his, you know, move his camera and call for muscle to help get him out of there. Well, she was certainly attempting to deny him his First Amendment right. I'm troubled with, and I'm a lawyer, but I'm troubled with our purely legalistic approach to these things, because the law gives folks rights that if they exercise them in every instance, there's going to be conflict. I'm trying to find that level of discourse, which I think we certainly need in a university, if nowhere else, where we understand the need to moderate our exercise of our rights in the interest of living in a civil society.
Let me ask you one final question, because we have to move to another conversation you'll be participating in. But what do you think happened in the culture on your campus that led students and some faculty to believe that they could deny First Amendment rights to other people in the course of pursuing what they thought to be a righteous cause? What changed?
Well, you know, the students fairly quickly, I think the next day, admitted that they had no right to claim that safe space. And they, in fact, said that the professor went overboard. And, you know, they were, I think, perfectly willing to allow the press into that circle if the press insisted. But they were trying to request some privacy in hopes that their request would be respected. The faculty member was just overly exuberant in trying to afford them that right that she thought they had claimed, and went overboard. She was a passionate woman who thought she was doing the right thing for the students. She was protecting the students.
One final thing, and both of you can do this very quickly. How is there a failure on the part of universities, and maybe high school teachers as well, to explain to students the paramount importance, at least this is the importance that I assign to it, the paramount importance of free speech, even the protection of offensive speech, speech that you find offensive? Is that something that's underlying these controversies? Or is that too simple?
I don't know that we know how to explain that. I mean, we know the law. We can teach them the legal standards. But when you get to regulating offensive speech, I think we've just started as a nation to inch into that when we developed all these hate crime enhancements for crime. That is something like a limitation on speech or a punishment of speech, but it has to be coupled with a crime, and you enhance the punishment. Right. Well, what these students are now saying is that, well, why do you need a crime? If the language is there and it's hate language, why can't you punish that too?
The language itself
ought to be enough.
Yeah. Is there something that troubles you about that?
It troubles me, but
I got that.
Well, it troubles me also. I mean, I'm no fan of hate speech either, but I absolutely believe agree with Jeffrey Stone, who started up here. Our universities have to be a place for all of this. It is the only way so we can learn the skills to condemn it, if nothing else. One thing that really did frustrate me a lot in the reporting when it came to the fall events on Yale's campus is that, you know, many different venues were talking about the student activists as trying to tamp down on free speech. No, actually. The students simply said, we just ask for your respect with Halloween costumes, and then it went, whether you like that or not is your own issue, but then it went into this other space. Everything the students did in the fall was the way in Yale's, we're guided by a report we call the Woodward Report, was free expression and free speech. I didn't like all of it. Lord knows there were some personal things said to me that I really will not forget, but I will defend the right to act that way. We have to protect the ugliest parts of who we are if we are going to realize our best parts. We have to, and it's miserable work to do, but it has to be done.
Very well put. Thank you very much, both of you. Very excellent. What we're going to do, I think, Jonathan, you're leaving. This is really like air traffic control. I think you're leaving us. You're going to stick around for a little bit, and we're going to bring up five more people now. Talk about free speech. We have too much free speech right now. And we're going to bring some chairs up. I'll introduce. Thank you very, very much. I'm going to introduce them. I'm just going to start introducing them, and please bring them up as fast as possible. We have a wide diversity of speakers. I mentioned Stephen Carter before. Very, very well-known Yale law professor, great novelist, very, very familiar to people at Aspen. Jonathan Greenblatt is going to be coming up in a second. He's the national director of the Anti-Defamation League. Kirsten Powers is coming up, columnist for USA Today, commentator on Fox. Greg Lukianoff is coming, one of the country's foremost advocates of free speech, especially in education. And Michael Roth, the president of Wesleyan University, which has had some of its own issues on this, like many universities. So please all come up as quickly as you can. And please welcome them up here. And by the way, please welcome them. Yes, yes, yes. Really, it's like two barbershop quartets. Somebody should just sit here. I'll move over here. How about that? Why don't we switch? Yeah, we'll switch so I can look at everybody. Looking at everybody. What a cast. After this panel, this is going to go on until 8 p.m. After this, we're actually going to do something. I'm sure some of you have had this thought. What about actual students? And we have three actual students who are going to come up here and critique their elders as soon as the elders finish. Or they might not critique it, but we have three very, very smart student editors who are going to talk about, for a few minutes, some of the pressures that they're under and to give their reactions to what they're hearing up here. But let me, because it's a large cast, I want to spend a couple of minutes with each person on particular questions. Greg, let me start, since you're over there at the end, let me start with you and ask you this. You are obviously known as a maximalist on these questions, a free speech absolutist. It's easy looking at Yale. There's serious things that happen at Yale, and there's some things that I think are not so serious. One of the not so serious things is what I would consider hypersensitivity about Halloween costumes, right? The Republic should not live or die on whether somebody wears a costume that somebody thinks is offensive. But I want to ask you this. Where is the line? Do you have any line in your advocacy? It's one thing to talk about offensive Halloween costumes. It might be another thing to say I endorse, for instance, a march of Nazis, neo-Nazis, across a university campus, a Skokie-style march, or a Ku Klux Klan rally at a public or private university. Is there any limit for you? Spend a minute talking about that.
Sure, yeah. I mean, it's come into sort of vogue in the past year, particularly with critics like Eric Posner throwing out, oh, you're a free speech fundamentalist. And when they run out of arguments, essentially, it's just some kind of aspersion. I'm a First Amendment lawyer. I teach First Amendment law. I think the restrictions that are presented under the First Amendment aren't just good law. They make good, solid sense. And I think that people very quickly, and I love the elitism of the idea that, my goodness, if we allowed freedom of speech, our campuses would be exploding with KKK rallies all over the place. And I think it's basically their way of saying, we don't really trust people to figure this stuff out on their own.
What would you not defend?
Oh yeah, we run into cases all the time. Actual harassment is not protected speech. Threats are not protected speech. Graffiti is not protected speech. Child pornography, obscenity is not protected speech. And if you were to ask Europeans about what the American system is like, they would think, time, place, and manner restrictions are protected. So I get asked about the KKK all the time, and meanwhile I have to deal with cases in which people are getting in trouble for mildly criticizing a parking garage project. You know, and so like the fact that suddenly everybody noticed what happened.
Very quickly, tell people what that case is.
Oh, sure, that's Hayden Barnes' case. This was a case in which a student was kicked out of Valdosta State University because he criticized a parking garage project. It's the opening story in my book, Unlearning Liberty. And so for me, I've been doing this for 15 years, and suddenly the entire world has noticed a problem with free speech on campus just because they noticed some big name schools and some and now that people are pointing at the students more often. And for the overwhelming majority of my career, it's actually been administrators, in some cases, you know, acting with the best of intentions, but in many other cases, acting like, you know, I don't like that student. One of my favorite cases in Florida was an administrator who actually had the chutzpah to tell a student that you can't protest for, I think it was PETA here, because I don't like PETA. And I was like, I love it because it was just so straightforward and honest.
Right, right. Stephen, you're on the Yale campus.
Occasionally. Yes.
Yeah, you're on the Yale campus. You've been watching this unfold on your campus. I wanted to get your reaction. I was watching that video, which is an interesting video, but the thumb was on the scale in one direction very clearly in that video. I wanted to get your reaction to what happened over the past year. I've heard you speak on this a little bit. You have,
I don't want to mischaracterize this, but I think less sympathy than other people for some of the specific complaints that are being leveled against the Yale administration.
Well, let me offer a slight corrective, not only the video, but in the course of the conversation, in a sense, that I have a lot of sympathy for these students, but it's not as though what you saw in the video happening at Yale is the only hate speech, free speech issue we confront. I had a student in my office talking to me not long ago, earlier this year, because she was upset because another professor at Yale had written a critique arguing that the data on campus rape are flawed. And she was furious. And there was a petition at Yale Law School objecting to this research, objecting to actually doing research in this area.
Objecting to data.
We've had this with, say, climate change. Now, I know climate change is a big problem. Some people on campus disagree. Well, let them disagree. Why do we have to suddenly say, well, we need to see all their emails, we know who's funding them? Those are all ways of trying to pressure and shut down speech. It's all the same thing. And so my view at Yale is, I think I'm with my friend Jonathan Holloway on this, I understand why the students are upset. And you hear their stories, you can't help but be sympathetic. However, I have a slightly different take on what happened. That is, it is true that there's a convulsion in the country, and part of the racial aspect of what we saw is a result of those convulsions. But there are other factors at play as well. One is the growth of administrators. There are enormous numbers of administrators on college campuses now, many of whom, most of whom, they're not trained historians. They don't come from a background of academic freedom. They come from a background of being trained in administration. Their job is to damp down problems. They have no sense of the mission of a university. There's a huge problem. There are many, many schools where administration is growing much faster than faculty at this point. Second problem is technology. That is, it is much easier than it was before for students to contact other students when they're upset in a way that wouldn't have been true years ago. You have, we talked about this earlier, you have a preference cascade in a sense, as each student says, you know, I feel that way too, I feel that way too, I feel that way too. In some sense, that's a good thing because it makes students feel they're not alone. But on the other hand, it can ramp up emotion to the point where all these concerns about academic freedom suddenly become, as some of the students said in the video, seem like an abstraction, like something that's not very important. Academic freedom is enormously, enormously important, not just for Jeff Stone's reasons, because you're talking about the battle of ideas. You're talking about why the Aspen Institute is here. The notion that we're going to start taking ideas off the table because we don't like them is enormously dangerous and threatens the enterprise.
Let me jump, since you leveled a fairly serious critique of administrators, let me ask another administrator here, the president of Wesleyan University, who also happens to be an academic. Is he right? Is this a problem that's driven by administrators who simply don't understand academic freedom, but understand the needs of their alleged constituency?
I think we agree on part of this. That is, I think we have seen an extraordinary growth of administrators, many of whom have to do the work that faculty members no longer want to do, like advising students,
teaching basic. I like the way you threw that back, by the way. That was good.
Thank you for noticing.
Yeah.
And because of an extraordinary amount of regulation from the federal and state governments, mostly federal governments. But there is a corporatization of the university, so someone may say, you don't like my decision on the parking lot? You're fired. Which can happen in many places. You don't like, and if you express disloyalty, it's insubordination, it's firing offense in many companies. It shouldn't be, clearly, at a college or university. However, that is not academic freedom. Academic freedom isn't the freedom to do whatever the hell you want on campus because it's an academic place. Academic freedom is a professional freedom about research and intellectual work. It's not about saying whatever you want. And we never have had, in this country, all ideas on the table. Even at the benighted Aspen Institute, there are some things you don't put on the table. You always have some things you refuse to legitimate by calling it a subject of debate. Are Jews controlling the media? Deep dive. Really? You're gonna do that deep dive? Is slavery in third world countries appropriate?
I can moderate that one, though, right? All right.
You're always taking things off the table. And when you have a group of fairly homogenous people, I have never seen one quite as homogenous as this in recent years, it's really easy to tell yourself, nothing is off the table. Almost everything our students are concerned with are not things that are going to be on your tables. Because your tables are well set, you're well fed, and we're well cared for. What we're experiencing today on college campuses, I think, and maybe we have a slight disagreement with my colleague at Yale, is that we have an extraordinary pressure from points of view that had been excluded at the university. And that has happened with women, and it has happened with low-income students, and it's happened on basis of race and ethnicity. And now they're raising issues that we were less comfortable with talking about. And some of us retreat to questions of free speech to say that, to kind of limit the speech of students in some strange ways. So I do feel that there are serious problems on college campuses. Just before coming here, I read the New York Times article this morning about a young man who was accused of two rapes and made a plea deal so that he would have a misdemeanor offense and not spend any time in jail. And I think on that campus, where women are raped every day, or every other day, if you don't like that's the first statistic, that is an extraordinary limitation on the freedom of women to get an education. That, to me, is much more important than whether the Halloween costume poster somehow violates our liberal sensibilities.
Thank you. Let me return to Kirsten for a minute. We've talked about this in the past. One of the differences, you're younger than I am, but one of the differences that strikes me between today's students and students when I was in college and before is that in those days, the dark old days, the students were opposed to the administration. Today, the students go to the administration to fix their problems. I mean, that's a caricature of what's happening. But it seems as if students go to the administration in order to make things right, instead of, as they did at Berkeley, starting at Berkeley in the 60s and moving forward, try to fix them themselves. Is that a fair assessment? And what does that say about youth and parenting and social media and all the rest?
I think it's fair, but
you do that in 140 characters.
You have to also remember that these administrations, for the most part, sell themselves that way. So they basically tell you, you're going to come here and you're going to be part of a family. So these students, these Yale students, were told, you're going to be part of a family, and then next thing you know, they're being told that, you know, people can dress up however they want, and it's going to offend, even if it offends you, we don't care. And so that's the perspective that they come from. Now, I think people should be able to wear whatever kind of Halloween costumes they want to, and if you're offended, I think you need to learn to deal with it. But I'm not unsympathetic to the students, and I'm a little, I do tend to place more of the emphasis on the administrators and, frankly, on some of the professors. Because if you look at some of the free speech infringement, sometimes it's even professors against the students. You know, there was a case, a lot of these cases were actually litigated by fire, by Greg, and one of them at the University of Alaska Fairbanks, you had a gender studies professor who launched a complaint against a student newspaper, against a female editor, African-American editor there, accused her of sexual harassment for a satirical piece making fun of the women's studies department. You see these kinds of things. You saw it at Marquette, where a student brought up something about same-sex marriage and was shut down in the classroom, told this is offensive, you cannot bring this up here. And so it's not just the students who are coming up with this on their own. I think they are learning it from other people. They are being told that you had a professor at the University of California, Santa Barbara, who ended up being arrested after she physically attacked a pro-life student because she said she'd been triggered by a pro-life sign. Well, all her students sat there and watched her do this. And she wasn't apologetic. She said she felt her safety had been threatened, and she needed to, you know, just setting a moral example for her students. And she took some of her students back to the office as they stole the sign and they destroyed it. So the students are learning this. They're learning that they have a right to protect themselves from speech. And it's incumbent on the professors and the administrators to educate them about this, and to educate them that the way you respond when you're offended is to argue and make your case. And I just want to say one other thing. I think on this video that we watched, I don't see that as a free speech issue. You know, I think those students have every right, I mean, I don't think they're infringing on anyone's free speech. They have every right to come out and say, we do not want this building to be named after somebody who owns slaves. I mean, if it's me, I say rename the building. And there's nothing wrong with that. I don't want to mix that up with the types of things that you were just talking about, which I think are when people are really trying to silence other people. They're not trying to silence anybody. They're voicing their opinion. You know, and there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, there's not only nothing wrong with it, I think we should applaud it.
Let me turn to Jonathan for a minute and talk about silencing. There's an issue that you're dealing with a lot, and I think everybody on a university campus has been seeing to varying degrees. There has been a movement over the past several years to shut down pro-Israel advocacy on campus, or to silence it, even to the point of protesting and trying to shout down visiting academics from Israel.
Yeah.
You have now a counter reaction in a lot of state legislatures and cities saying that advocates of the BDS movement, the boycott, divestment, and sanction movement, should be punished for advocating trying to shut down free speech. I'm boiling this down to try to boil it down to its essence. Diagnose the problem for us really quickly, if you can, and tell us where the ADL stands on this. And it just seems to me that this is a classic case of unintended consequences. People who are protesting something they don't like, in this case Israeli policy or Israel's existence, are triggering a counter effect. They're not drawing counter speech. They're drawing counter censorship. Is that what we're seeing?
Well, I think we're conflating a few things to begin with.
By we, you mean me?
Pardon?
By we, you mean me.
There you go. Okay. Yeah. But I'm excited about our panel that Michael's going to do with us on Jews controlling the media.
Yeah, so yeah,
the Ideas
yeah.
Festival 2017.
Yeah. That'll be in the Greenwald Pavilion, by right. the way.
That's right. So a few things. I mean, I think at the ADL, we are fierce advocates for the First Amendment, and we deeply believe in academic freedom. I think, as you were saying earlier, there's something a little bit different, though, about the freedom to express your opinion and the freedom to threaten others, and creating an environment that's open to different ideas and creating a hostile environment. So that's where we draw the line, when sort of expressing ideas becomes actually issuing threats. And it's real. So we've seen incidences where pro-Israel speakers, for example, have been shouted down or prevented from speaking, which is ironic because obviously that's, you know, that is limiting their freedom of speech. And we've seen where some of these, and I'm talking about something very narrow here for a moment, these sort of anti-Israel demonstrations mutate into things like swastikas on Jewish fraternities or Jewish students being physically intimidated. That's a real problem, and we think that's unacceptable. We think that should be unacceptable whether it was a Jewish student targeted, and that's what we're talking about in this narrow example, or other students. So the idea of wanting to change the name of a building because it evokes something painful in our history, there's nothing wrong with expressing that idea. But there's something wrong with intimidating and physically threatening people along the way. So I would say with respect to this BDS movement that Jeff alluded to, that some of you may be familiar with, many of the proponents of the movement believe in this notion, which is so inimical to academic freedom, which is anti-normalization, which is they believe that the idea of normalizing relations with Israel, with whom they disagree with for political reasons, normalization is a problem. So the anti-normalization agenda means you boycott, you push out, you marginalize. And again, that to me seems totally counter to what we think about as freedom of
Thank you. I want to come back to that with some of the other panelists, but I want to ask Michael Middleton a question, and it's based on a recent conversation I had at Wesleyan. I happened to be at Wesleyan a few weeks ago, Michael Roth's campus, picking up a certain 19-year-old I'm related to. And as tradition holds, I took that 19-year-old and a bunch of other 19-year-olds out to a nice dinner. And we spent a lot of time talking about some of the tumult on campus. And the good thing about Wesleyan is there's a wide divergence of opinion. And one thing that I heard that really struck me, it was one of my daughter's friends, said this. In my experience, I don't mean to be condescending to the panelists who are about to come up, but this was a 19-year-old with an unusually deep historical understanding. And this particular student said, you know, one of the things that's a joke about all of the protests, about sensitivity and about, there was a reference to the Halloween costume incident, which is just down the road at Yale, was that we axiomatically, by being members of the Wesleyan community, one of the best colleges in America, are in the top 1% of lucky people in the history of the universe. And this particular person was saying that getting a little tired of listening to students complain about things while the Syrian genocide is going on, while there's mass flows of refugees across the world, while there's Ferguson, while there's a whole bunch of other stuff. Talking about sensitivity issues on campus seems almost inappropriate. And I wanted to ask you, you have vast experience in this. Is that a legitimate discourse? You certainly hear that in people who are older than college students, which is to say, to put it in a crude way, shut up and enjoy Yale, or shut up and enjoy the fact that you're among the luckiest people in the history of the planet.
Yeah, that's been said. and
that's
you
been
know,
said by donors, I'm sure.
Yeah, by many donors and legislators and parents and other students. But the student's response is that I don't hate Mizzou. I'm trying to make Mizzou better. I love Mizzou. But you need to understand this is how I am feeling. This is how I am being treated here. And we can be better. So it's not like love it or leave it, which is what they used to tell me when I was protesting. I love it, and I want it to be better. There's also the assertion that students are too coddled nowadays.
Yeah.
They need to toughen up, you know, and there is something to that. I grew up in Mississippi in the 40s and 50s, and I developed a pretty thick skin pretty early in life. And the things that these students are experiencing today would roll off my back because I learned that I had to let it roll off my back or I might be hung somewhere. These students haven't had to learn that. They haven't had to have that harsh an upbringing. And so they're simply saying that they are experiencing what I experienced, what Jonathan experienced, what every African American, what many Jewish people in recent years have been experiencing on these campuses. We are experiencing this, and it needs to be fixed. And administration needs to pay attention. Because administration has told us that you've created this wonderful family. We had a huge campaign called One Mizzou with a song and a little video, and it was beautiful. It was We Are the World. The students, the marginalized students, laughed at that. They said, this is not One Mizzou, and we are here to tell you why it's not One Mizzou and how it should be One Mizzou. So yeah, I mean, there's that position has some validity, but it isn't everything. And can I say something about the speech issue? I mean, I get the sense that we're making light of Halloween costumes and that kind of thing. But what happens, I mean, I have an obligation as a university administrator to protect my students against harassment, a hostile environment. What happens when the Klan wants to march on the quadrangle every day and shout the N-word at my African-American students, asserting their free speech rights? Am I infringing on their free speech rights when I try to limit that? They're not actually threatening. It's not a true threat. Do I have to listen to that?
Well, that comes up, as far as the law is concerned, that comes up in the real example, because I don't know of a Klan example, but in the real example, street preachers.
Or neo-Nazi groups.
Oh, but street preachers are the normal example, and this happens all over the country, where street preachers have an area on campus where they're a free speech zone, and the rules that apply to people who aren't students or faculty members can actually be different for people who aren't there already legally. So you can't actually say that this is the designated area.
Well, in Missouri, they've changed that. The whole campus is a free speech
right,
zone.
But only for students and faculty members. And that was a law that we actually helped.
I know. I knew you were involved
in that. We helped support.
Steve, can I just come back, maybe Stephen and Michael, on this point of coddling? Mm-hmm. Because this is what comes up in the mainstream dialogue, mainstream discourse about this. Do students need to be tougher? Is that something that needs to happen? Or is that, or are they trying to make the world a safer space?
Those aren't inconsistent. That is, it can be that they have to be tougher, which I do believe. But I also believe, for the most part, they act with sincerity of motive. But let me tell you one little story to make the earlier point. You know, I don't hate outrageous speech. I think it's actually very important. I was an undergraduate at Stanford when William Shockley, the Nobel laureate in physics, was expounding his theories about the racial inferiority of black people. I, of course, was a black person at Stanford at the time. And this is at a time when he would travel around the country trying to speak and be shut down at various campuses. People would protest and block, and people were boycotting him at Stanford and trying to get him fired. And I was in the minority of students who thought that was an absurd reaction, that the right reaction is, you know, let's listen to the guy's argument. And so it ended up happening, actually. I actually saw it in two different venues. One was, I was an editor of the campus paper, and we had him come in for a lunch with the editorial board, and he freely answered all the questions we had. He was actually, and that was a very useful exercise, I think, for both sides. But then the larger one, which you and I talked about earlier, Jeff, was that a campus debate was arranged, and there was Shockley debating a world-renowned geneticist, a fellow named Luigi Luca Cavalli Sforza. I like saying his name. And this was a very important moment, because Shockley, by and large, when he had been debated, had debated activists, whether student activists or professional activists or professors who were activists, and he always talked circles around them. They made him look good by the lack of seriousness, and I mean professional academic seriousness, with which he treated the conversations. The geneticist just sliced up his argument bit by bit by bit, brilliantly. And actually, after that, Shockley was basically finished. He was basically finished not because he'd been boycotted, not because he'd been kept from speaking, but precisely because he had not been allowed to speak, but had a serious debate with a serious person in the field. And by the way, and Cavalli Sforza was not rude to him. He wasn't making snide remarks. He simply talked about the genetics and the biology and the statistics, and that was all. And so when people who sit where I sit on a campus say that we are First Amendment absolutes, right, which I pretty much am, and when we say the cure for speech is more speech, it's not a slogan. It's not a way of escaping hard issues. It's a way of embracing hard issues. It's a way of saying, if this is really so terrible, that's exactly the reason to talk about it.
Let me ask Michael Roth something about that. As a university president, one of the many things you have to do is pick commencement speakers. And we know that another manifestation of this anxiety in society is over and over again, university students protesting the choice of commencement speakers or different kinds of speakers. We've seen it become increasingly mainstream to the point where people like Condoleezza Rice, Madeleine Albright, are met with protests when universities announce that they're going to get an honorary degree or something like that. Have you experienced that yourself? And what do you think is causing that? I mean, it seems as if what the students are asking for is a smooth ride through commencement. They don't want to hear anything or see someone they don't like.
Well, commencement is a ceremony for the students, and I think the idea that somehow Madeleine Albright or Condoleezza Rice would get up there and teach them something while they're making their speech about how to become who they really are is silly. And so I think the students, as consumers of a very expensive education, which is part of this that changes, is that these are people who feel that they're paying $65,000 a year and they are entitled to certain things. I mean, there is part of that. I don't like that, but that's a part of this. And at commencement, they're not protesting against Condoleezza Rice because they don't like her views. Some people think she's a war criminal. Right. And so they make their voices heard. I think they should make their voices heard. And I don't think that Condoleezza Rice is being prohibited from getting her message out. I think that doesn't make a lot of sense. But I do think the difference between us, perhaps, on this issue is that some of us up here apparently have a very, very deep faith that the way social change happens is that you have a civil discussion, a reasoned debate, and that people, through more speech, get closer to the truth. And I think, as a historian, that's crazy. That's not how social change happens.
That's not what I think.
And I don't think Mr. Shockley changed his mind.
That's not at all what I said. And it's not what I think. I think on a university campus, the way that you teach, the way that you learn, the way you progress is through conversation. People have to be in the streets sometimes about things. It happens all the time. It's happened all history. I agree with you entirely. But we're talking about what happens on campus and not what happens in the rest of the world.
And on campuses, protest has been an important feature of how those campuses have changed, as you well know.
And I've been a protester.
Yes, and as have I. So I think that almost all the time, it's good to err on the side of speech. But there are some times when students rightly say, you have been erring on the side of speech for 60 years, and we are noticing that the same thing happened to you, the same thing happened to you, the same thing's happening again, and what you want to do is talk about it. And we think, oh wait, off campus change happens because we do something. We don't just talk about it. So I think they're quite reasonable to sometimes take the action which will change the nature of the conversation.
We only have a few minutes left. Thank you for that. Greg, I just wanted you to get your reaction to that particular exchange, because I'm curious from the maximalist perspective how you view that.
I just think it's interesting, and this is the second time I've been in sort of a debate with President Roth. Wesleyan actually was one of my worst schools for free speech in the past year. And it was actually the one that you probably,
well,
one of the stories you
have
probably
to give Roth a rebuttal, so we're going to go over
you,
now.
You probably didn't hear about was that a conservative student wrote an editorial saying that he disagreed with some of the tactics of the Black Lives Matter movement. And student protesters got together and demanded that the paper be defunded and that they will recycle copies, as in destroy runs of the newspaper, until their demands were met. Within a couple weeks of that, the student government coincidentally slashed the budget of the student newspaper by $15,000, fully half of it. And what we needed Michael Roth to do was to come forward and stop this. Now, to his credit, this whole process of the university, of the student government, getting rid of the funding of the student newspaper, the Argus. They got rid of all of the funding, actually, this past spring. They took it back for themselves. Michael did get involved, and so this finally resolved, I don't know, about a month and a half ago. But in my opinion, that was not a hard case. This is not one of these like ridiculous cases, these straw man cases that he keeps on bringing up, where essentially it's like, oh my God, it was a really hard choice. It's like, no, you should tell students you can't destroy runs of student newspapers, and that students can write articles that are mildly critical of Black Lives Matter.
Let me ask Michael, should those students have been punished for destroying runs of papers?
No one destroyed runs of papers. So the Argus didn't lose any of its money.
It lost $15,000.
Because
outside donors gave money.
No,
that's right.
The Argus has the same funding next year as it had this year. And that very helpful interventionists like people from FIRE wanted to make this seem as if this was an extraordinary moment in the history of free speech and journalism, when I think what happened was is that some students said, this newspaper has gone too far, we want to defund it, which is a really bad thing to do. And I actually, at the very moment, wrote a piece called Black Lives Matter, So Does Free Speech. There was an intense debate on campus. Some people started the debate thinking, like the bad guys from your point of view, the newspaper should not publish that kind of thing. And if they do, they should be defunded. By the end of the school year, it did take them a while, they realized this was a really bad idea because in the future, we want to have a newspaper that has the rights for free expression. I thought that was a victory for student learning. Instead of having a lawyer come in and say, you get a red light, a sticker on your school because you're bad for free speech, the students actually figured out that free speech matters. And so do other things.
I mean, you had a good conversation about it.
We had a great conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. We can agree, we'll all agree on lawyers. Kirsten, I'm going to ask you to do something to close that's probably impossible, but sort of cast forward and answer the question. These sorts of incidents, do you think that they are going to, the velocity of these sort of incidents, is it going to increase? Do you think that we're in a particularly fevered moment? And where do you think this is going? Do you think that, as Michael Roth has suggested, the students at Wesleyan came to what most of us would consider a reasonable conclusion about the destruction of newspapers? I know you're dying to say something, but don't. Or are we just in this for a long time to come, in which, from your perspective at least, students don't fully understand that offensive speech should be protected and be fought with good speech?
Well, I think a year ago I would have said that this is a growth business, it's going to keep happening, but now we're starting to have some conversations about it. And I think the more we talk about it and the more seriously people take it and we start having conversations on campus, maybe we can try to reach some sort of middle ground on the issue. And I do agree with Greg, though, we often have these sort of straw man arguments of things that aren't happening versus talking about what actually is happening. And what actually is happening, take the commencement speeches and set them aside. I take your point that the students, you know, it's their commencement. The bigger problem, frankly, is that students try to stop speakers coming on campus that they aren't even going to go here to speak. So you have libertarian groups who invite somebody to come and speak, an academic. You have conservative groups who invite someone to speak, a pro-life group. And you have outside groups. You have George Will coming to speak somewhere, and you know, feminists are upset with him for a column. None of these people are even going to go to the speech, and they're trying to stop the speech. They're trying to stop other people from hearing information. They're trying to stop people from expressing information. This has happened to Christina Hoff Summers, who, you know, is an AEI scholar, and she's a critic of feminism, or she has a different view of feminism. And you know, she is recently at Oberlin and at Georgetown was given security to go on campus because there was so much of a disruption about her coming on campus. This has never happened to her before. She's been speaking on campuses for 30 years. You have safe spaces set up for students who, again, were never going to the speech in the first place. What these students should be doing is they should be going to the speech and they should be challenging Christina, which she is more than happy. Most of these people are more than happy to debate the issues. And in fact, she says that's what used to happen.
Right. Finally, Jonathan, you're leading a large national civil rights organization. Does, and I make this purposely simplistic, do the pursuit of civil rights and equality have to be in conflict in the way it is in some people's minds with the absolute right to free speech?
No, I don't think so. Again, I think that there is no absolute right to
anything. What is the manifestation of then? What is going on here in a deepest way?
The tension? I think the tension is that we live in complicated times, and these are complicated issues, and rarely are things as black and white as we might like them to be in a newspaper column or like when someone's writing an op-ed. It requires rolling up your sleeves and getting in there and solving these problems step by step or laying it down brick by brick. So I just believe that, you know, there aren't easy ways to solve this stuff. It requires working together. And frankly, that's what happens. That's what happens on the best college campuses.
We could go on all day, but we can't. Thank you very much to all of you. I really appreciate this panel. And now we're going to find out what you said that was wrong. We're going to bring up these three great college students, and we're going to have them come in. Let me introduce them as they come up. Thank you very much, all of you. Forrest Sill is the co-editor of the Chicago Maroon with Maggie Loughran, and Paige Ladisic is the recently former editor, of the Daily Tar Heel at UNC, and we're going to spend a few minutes talking with them. As soon as they work their way by their elders. Why don't you come on? You got handhelds, so that's good. So thank you all three of you for being here. Is Aspen really as white as they say?
Well, okay, so Maggie and I go to the University of Chicago. It's a little whiter than Chicago, so
all right.
Yeah.
Let me start with the three of you, and we have just a few minutes to do this. Let me start. I don't want to start by getting your reaction about this. I want to ask you, as college editors, I was a college editor, a lot of people who are on the panel are college editors. Are there things now that you are too afraid to print? Do you run into situations where you think, if I publish this, my entire run of a newspaper, for instance, is going to be stolen? We're going to be the targets of direct protests. Is that something that you fear actively?
No, never. You guys are about to start your editor-in-chiefship, and I just finished mine.
We're halfway through.
Oh, you're halfway through? My apologies, I'm sorry. So I printed a daily paper, Monday through Friday, and I felt that if you read the Daily Tar Heel on a Wednesday, you're sitting in your class, not paying attention, and you're reading, and you get to the end of that paper, and you say, I love the Daily Tar Heel. They just wrote every single thing I'm thinking. They agreed with me 100%, and I feel so much better about this newspaper and this campus, and I am so happy. Then I am furious, and I did a bad job, and I need to work better the next day to piss you off. Like, you should read my paper and be angry. And I published a column this year, and the column's title was, White People, This Ain't For You. I am a white woman who is in charge of a newspaper at a university that is majority white, at a newspaper that is majority white, and this column was about how white people are boring, white people are paying attention to the wrong arguments, and white people are attacking people of color for the wrong things. And I didn't agree with everything that that columnist said, and I knew that the next day people were going to call for my independent of the university newspaper to receive all of its university funding that it doesn't receive. But I knew that was going to happen, and I was scared out of my mind to publish it. But if I didn't publish it, I wasn't doing my job.
And what happened?
Same thing I thought. Next day, you need to lose your job. Tell me, I mean, sometimes I wish I would. Yeah. You know, it's hard. It's so hard to wake up and be 22 years old and people tell you how terrible you are and how racist you are, and you are a white privileged woman.
But maybe you two can answer this question. And this is the thing that I genuinely don't understand sometimes. Why is the urge when a student on a campus reads something that offends them, why is their first impulse not to say quite often, let me write an op-ed to counter that op-ed, but why is the impulse to bring me the head of the editor who had the temerity to put that in the newspaper in the first place? What is that impulse?
Well, I think this was echoed with some of our previous panelists. These are people who feel like we've been having these kind of conversations for decades now. Things still haven't changed. The core issues that are being at universities are reflections of issues that are at society at large, and those are they're trying to use activism at the university to change the societal issues. And there have been thousands of op-eds about these issues, and things haven't changed, and so they're trying something different. And I've got to give him credit for it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very passionate debate. It's a fascinating debate. I certainly fall on the side of free speech. I think it would be irresponsible of me not to as an editor-in-chief of a paper. But yeah, like Forrest was saying, these issues go back a long time, and people are tired of the back and forth, and they want action. And so, you know, we can't be afraid to publish anything. But certainly, I get butterflies in my stomach before we promote some of our articles on social media, because you have to have thick skin, and you have to know what's coming for you.
How free are you, really, to publish conservative viewpoints, strident conservative viewpoints, let's say, in your newspaper?
I mean, we're completely free to do so. We're independent from the university. The university itself is historically a pretty conservative institution relative to other higher education institutions. We're free to publish whatever we want, and we do.
I'm really going to put you guys on the spot here in front of a large group of people who are your parents' ages and grandparents' ages and maybe even more in a couple of cases. But there are a lot of people want to understand why it seems that your generation is unusually sensitive to slights. Let's call it that. Can you, and again, I don't expect you to speak on behalf of your entire generation, but can you explain what is, if you even believe that phenomenon is a legitimate phenomenon, or do you think that we're just sort of making this up?
Okay, so I don't want to get in trouble for this. My main complaint with college activists is that they largely seem entitled to their own set of facts. And that's totally antithetical to how a newspaper works, which is based on a single set of facts. So then we come into this conflict in the newspaper business where we're trying to deal with these people that just have such a fundamentally core difference. And I'm not sure how that really touches on these slights, but they believe that it's founded or based in experience, and that having this one single truth isn't how the world works. And I categorically disagree with that, but lots of college students do not.
Does that ring true with your experience?
Yeah, I mean, it makes our job a little harder than it ought to be. There was a major debate over divestment, divestment from companies that are active in Israel, in Palestine this year, and there was a student government was voting on whether to pass a resolution calling on the university to divest, and the university is always very politically hands off. I agree that it should be. But this was kind of making a big statement on behalf of the student body of the University of Chicago. And we went to the college council meeting, and there were protesters on both sides, and we were told that we weren't allowed to record the meeting or take photos after a certain point because people felt unsafe by that. And So, you know, we assembled a team of about 10 reporters to make sure that we had our quotes as accurate as they could be. But it was a frustrating moment, and I think that it was kind of indicative of the debate that's going on and of the tension.
Why would students possibly feel unsafe having a civil debate about a serious issue on a university campus in the United States?
I think that as we, it especially happens for us on University of North Carolina's campus when it comes to the Black Lives Matter movement and renaming campus buildings. But I think that they are so set and they know what is right to them. And they feel that they have been persecuted against for many, many years of their life and that they have been harmed by racism, institutional racism and otherwise, that by the time they have gotten to college, it's time to stop, that they can't take it anymore. And I think sometimes that turns into they are afraid of anything that could possibly question their ideas. And that means that, similar to you, we were talking about this earlier, the University of North Carolina's Black Student Movement and a few other organizations held a People of Color caucus on our main public space. And we, as the Daily Tar Heels, chose a reporter who was a person of color because they asked that no white people attend. And we asked that reporter to go and cover it, and she was removed immediately. So they were so afraid of our presence that we couldn't even be there.
Is what you're describing, and maybe all three of you can answer this, is what you're describing a failure of students, or is it a failure of your teachers, the people who taught you about participating in a democracy like this?
I don't feel like I was taught to be like this. I went to North Carolina Public School. I'm a journalism student, so I've taken a lot of media law courses, but I don't feel like I was.
I want to ask you about you personally. I mean, where is the failure? Where is the failure in the system?
I think that it was mentioned earlier. I think that when we see administrators and teachers hearing a trigger warning and reacting violently, that's where they're taught.
Yeah, I mean, I think the onus always falls on individual shoulders. And so the university is not a political agent, nor should it be, but the people who attend that university are, and the people who teach there are. And so, you know, it's appropriate for those groups to engage each other. I think that where this problem starts is a complicated one. You could say parents, you could say teachers, certainly. But I mean, it has to do with people coming from very diverse backgrounds and with very different stories coming together, and that's what makes it so kind of passionate and hard to put your finger on.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I didn't come up with this myself, but it's an idea that the students today feel that language really has maybe more power than it did in years past, and that they're going to do what they can to control that in a way that their parents might not have.
Is that, you're getting at the nub of something, is that one of the differences between now and then, that people have ascribed to language the power of violence?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I would say that's why people want to rename buildings on college campuses, because they think those names have power that they didn't maybe 20 years ago, when I think most of us probably would have found those names just as offensive.
Let me ask you one final question, and what I'm going to ask you for now is a critique of what you've heard before. Large group of academics, university administrators, experts, talking about this set of issues. From the last hour and a half, what do you think was missing from this conversation? You don't have to name names, obviously, although it'd be interesting if you did. What are we not getting? That's a tough one. Talk about this conversation.
I think it's not that we're not getting it, because I think people are hitting on it a little, but I think we're not realizing how important it is that simple debate is so important, and we're not teaching our students the power of simple debate anymore. We're giving
When you say simple debate, you mean the idea
putting one side up against the other in front of a room and letting them talk it out, and at the end, you know, people can decide who they believe more. I think when students have the power to shut a speaker down is when that's so important. That campuses aren't reacting to that and trying to stop students from shutting a speaker down. Protest it all day long. Stand outside the door and yell and yell and yell and yell, but don't come in and yell and interrupt and scream or block them from entering.
Very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, schools can't be afraid of their students, and I think we see an increasing trend towards, there was an article in the New York Times about a week ago
about this new consumer model that's emerging. And so students, someone was discussing this, but students pay $65,000 in tuition per year, and they expect their demands to be met. They expect to be catered to and to be listened to.
So you would tell university presidents to get more of a spine?
To be quite honest, yes. And I think our university has done a good job with that. I've said this before, like, the status quo should always be challenged, and there should be healthy debate among individuals. But yeah, on an institutional level, the university's core mission is to be encouraging free speech and dialogue and back and forth debate. It's scary and it's a little disturbing when we see that challenge so often. Even though, I agree with Jeffrey Stone that, like, the solution is not condemning free speech or infringing on free speech. We need to come together, learn from each other, and find alternate solutions.
Farish, you get the last word.
We brought up a ton of great examples of how people reacted to different freedom of speech incidents. But what we didn't touch on is how so much of college students' lives takes place online. And especially, our lives just totally, so much of them take place online, but especially our political activity takes place online. They take place on Facebook pages, they take place on Twitter, they take place on our cell phones, and that presents a whole new range of options, especially with social media, I think that's going to be the next frontier.
What does that mean?
Well, I mean, I think largely it means that companies like Facebook are going to be the next frontier of free speech. That's where it's going to move on from, let's talk about university administrators, let's talk about the coders and the leaders of Facebook, and they're going to be the ones who we accuse of not being free enough. And I think that's where the conversation is going to have to move.
Well, that'll be the next deep dive. Thank you very much. You guys are great. Thank you very much for sitting there, and we appreciate it very much. Thank you.